Okay, how's that? So here we are. We have one more session on sutras. And I think we covered a lot of ground, I think, about the Buddha Garland Sutra or the Flower Ornament Sutra. Inconceivable liberation, so no need to go over that. And I think I did quite thoroughly discuss with you the goddess chapter. Did you? How many of you remember earlier we looked at the goddess chapter where the goddess and Shariputra have their little encounter? although I didn't do one thing in the goddess chapter, which is kind of good to prepare for Tantra. And because that's what we're going to do next session. Starting on the 9th, we're talking about science, and then we go on into Tantra. But actually, earlier than when she goes after him about his sexism, she does this thing where he asks about a marvelous exchange between Vimalakirti and them. I think we did this, the love that is firm. Did I read that paragraph to you? The love that is firm, it's high resolve, unbreakable like a diamond. The love that is pure. I did that, I think, didn't I, in that chapter? Did I go over that chapter with you? Yes or no? Maybe I skipped to the gender thing, you know, where, because that's always such a spectacular thing. I might do that. I was going to do the next thing, but maybe I'll do this. So at the beginning of this chapter, which is the goddess chapter, 6 in this version, but it was 7 in the printed version. They have a great dialogue. Manjushri asks Vimalakirti what he thinks about how a bodhisattva sees living beings. And Vimalakirti does this whole thing about basically sees the living beings like an illusion, like illusory, something illusory, which is kind of shocking to everyone. But it means that, for example, oh, hi, how are you? There you are. Which is like, you know, because you see someone, like, you know, I see my friend Ina, so I say, hello, how are you? And she doesn't look like an illusion to me. But on the other hand, I know that she is herself part of Buddha's body of truth, Dharmakaya, and which is indivisible, of course, from the body of beatitude. Or you could say she's transparent. She's clear light or transparent and pure emptiness, like everyone, but emptiness configured in the form of a being which is made of pure bliss. So bliss void indivisible being, which is transparent. So he's saying Bodhisattva sees beings like that, although it doesn't mean that she's quite like a Buddha, which is inexpressible, where completely simultaneously, without any kind of cognitive dissonance tolerance, where you see the individuated being picked out by discriminating intuition, and at the same time you have the ultimate reality perfection intuition sort of underneath it, which makes you see through them. So then the way that you see them has an illusory quality, if you follow me, like when you see a scene on television, which is just a scene transmitted, you know, and then interpreted by the photon gun in the back of the Sony Trinitron or whatever it is, but it looks like a person there, you know, right? So that's an illusory person, but still, this is having a scene going on and a thing like that, and yet it's just made of electronic impulses, right? In the matrix we live in when we watch TV. So he gives a bunch of those illusory things. So then, Manjushri asked Vimalakirti very logically. I don't think I read you this passage, but stop me if I did, because I'm sorry, my age, I forget, and I've been teaching Vimalakirti in another setting. But then Manjushri says, well, you know, if a bodhisattva considers all living beings in such a way, like more or less like an illusory, how does he generate the great love, or conceive the great love toward them? In other words, how can it be the great love, you know, of the Buddha? What kind of a love is that? That sees the object of love as an illusion. And even he doesn't add to that. And that their reality is actually bliss, because they're made of the clear light, everything is. Everything is the clear light, in its ultimate reality. In its relative reality, it has its relational form. But it's really the clear light from Buddha's vision. Being one with the clear light, the Buddha's body, the Buddha's sense of embodiment, it incorporates everything, because it is all made of clear light, right? So then why would you love something where the being is already bliss, you see it already made of bliss? You see it in a determinative or discriminating way, but simultaneously you see it as transparently made of pure bliss, and a bliss that is indivisible from you and your bliss, because you're a Buddha, right? Or the Bodhisattva may be a little short of that completely. So then he has this passage, and I didn't read this to you, I think, but I'm going to read it to you. But if I did, please stop me. He says, Manjushri, when a Bodhisattva considers all living beings in this way, he thinks, just as I have realized the Dharma, so should I teach it to living beings. And remember here, Dharma would be mistranslated if it was translated as doctrine, you know, or some sort of, you know, theory or something. By teaching Dharma, he means teaching the parameters, the indications, the vectors of reality itself, because ultimately Dharma is reality. So when he's saying that, just as I have realized reality, because the reality is where everybody is bliss. Actually, I did a radio show today. I think it's radio, it might be some kind of low budget television, but it was ABC with a guy called Dan Harris, who has a show called 10 Degrees, 10% Happier, it's called. And I did a show with him, and he kept asking me, well, what evidence do I have that everything is clear light of bliss, you know? And he was coming from the point of view of his Theravada. He has himself learned to meditate, Theravada thing, where they think of Nirvana as separate from this. You know, and he asked me, what was the difference between, the reason he asked me that was because he started out asking me, what's the difference between Theravada and Mahayana? And I was explaining to him that the Mahayana is more challenging in a way, because the Theravada has a dualistic worldview on purpose, which is a kind of interpretable worldview in Buddhist hermeneutical or interpretive strategies. In other words, it's not Buddha's final thought, but it's necessary for some people who can't imagine that they're already in Nirvana. You know, that would make them it would make them deprecate Nirvana, or make them think the whole thing was silly because they have a pain in their toe, so how could this be Nirvana? And so for those people, Buddha purposely let them think and even strive for the idea that Nirvana is somewhere outside of the universe. It's an escape from the differentiated phenomena of the universe. Right? But that's a little bit easier to strive to achieve that kind of freedom, renounce engagement with all these relative things, to try to find this their true reality. And when they do find a true reality by having some kind of realization of selflessness or emptiness, wherein they have an experience as if everything disappears, and then when they come back from that, they just think, well, I'll go back there when I die. You know? I'm just backed by some sort of habit energy of having a body and being a person. You know, that's what the Theravada people think. And later when I die, I'll have my final Nirvana, like Buddha, you know. By mistranslating the word pari, final, that's what I've explained to you, as meaning final, which it doesn't mean. It means thorough or complete. So what Buddha's parinirvana meant was, he expanded his awareness from his separate-looking body to being everything, which means he can completely manifest any other body anytime, actually, really. Shakyamuni could like show up as a taxi driver, a Uber driver outside, without a problem. If he thought that would help somebody, he has no desire to manifest or not manifest, either way. So he kept saying, well, what is your evidence that there is such a clear light of the void, you know, bliss, void, indivisible, infinity, what's evidence of that, and so on and so on. He kept pressing me. And so I said, well, but anyway, I don't want to go into that, but it's hard to understand. In other words, he was finding it hard to understand. Then I did explain, he did understand it. He actually did. Then again, he walked me back through it. He asked me to walk back through it for his listeners. You know. Because really, for example, infinity, just take infinity, never mind about bliss or anything. We are all completely one with infinity, right? Everybody, right now. I feel like I'm a finite being, but I'm also one with infinity, right? Because infinity couldn't be excluded from my feeling of being separately one, or it wouldn't be infinity, right? It would be excluded from some place. So we're all simultaneously infinity and seeming finitude already. I mean, it's easily, logically understandable. And furthermore, everything in nature is a continuity. And then I used Wittgenstein's thing with him, common sense thing, that even he came to that realization in dealing with Russell and Frege on this, where he said a boundary, you know, like you hear from scientists sometimes, there's only so and so many stars or galaxies in the universe, and if there's more, that's because they're too far away and they're fleeing, they're trying to run away from our polluted planet so fast that their light couldn't get back to us, you know, over many billion light years, you know, trillion, zillion light years, right? So it's virtually we're alone in the universe, and it's a bounded universe, and it's finite, and there's only so many stars. You hear that from these people, right? But that's ridiculous. How do they know? It could be like a black curtain, you know? The whole universe could be inside a shaman's black velvet bag, pitch dark, and outside it is a shaman out there shaking his rattle. I mean, it's completely silly. No, just because you can't see doesn't mean that it doesn't go on and on. And everything we've ever experienced in the universe has continuity. And those materialists who will say such things as it had a beginning with the Big Bang, or there's a limit to it like this and that, you know, what evidence is there for infinity? And people who say that are disregarding their own second law of thermodynamics about matter and energy, that no energy can ever be destroyed, in a way no energy can ever be created. And therefore, it's beginningless and endless. Because that's common sense, in the sense that's anything anybody has ever observed or experienced. Right? So I think I got through to him with that one. So, but then the idea that it's bliss, you know, that the default, the underlying reality of the universe is bliss. Buddha is teaching that, both in Theravada too, because the Third Noble Truth of Nirvana is the only one that's really real. Nirvana is the only one that's really real. This seeming non-Nirvana is unreally real. It's still real, but it's more illusory and unreal, luckily. And the bliss one is more real. So kind of you fall into the more reality if you ever lose the unreality type of thing. So anyway, that's I was into that. So the illusory, and seeing them as illusory doesn't mean that they don't matter and doesn't mean that they don't exist. So then Vimalakirti can go ahead. So he says, just as I have realized the Dharma, so should I teach it to living beings. Thereby, this is what he thinks, you know, that's what the Bodhisattva thinks. Because that understanding of reality as being basic goodness, basic infinity of energy, basic sufficiency for any need, ability to satisfy any need, and no pain, freedom, full energy, energy bath, infinite energy bath of bliss that everybody is made of. So, but then why would you bother to love them? They're already cool. Well, except they're a little bit not cool because they don't know that that's what they are. And you didn't know either, and you realized that made you suffer. And so now that you know that, you realize the one thing they really want is to know it themselves. And so your love for them, meaning wishing for them to be as happy as they actually are, is not impeded by the fact that you see them ultimately free of suffering, because you don't ignore that they are relatively not free of suffering because of their ignorance, right? The fact that they're ignorant is cause of their suffering means that if they knew their own reality, they wouldn't suffer, which means that their reality is without suffering. Okay? Did you follow that? He followed that. So 10% happier, I said, so Buddha wants us all to be 100% happier, not just 10, I said, but bit by bit, just a little bit happier is also good. So, you know, the famous Bill Murray statement in the movie, one of my favorite movies, What About Bob? Some of you may have seen, where he's supposed to be crazy, but he goes around, say, talking about baby steps, you know, maybe because he's supposed to be crazy, but he goes on the bus to go somewhere else, and then he brings his goldfish with him in a plastic bag, talks to them, says, baby steps, we get on the bus, and we go here. He ends up driving the shrink crazy. If you ever saw the movie, Richard Dreyfuss is the shrink, who's like worried about him being crazy, but it turns out Richard Dreyfuss is actually crazy. It's a very funny movie. I don't know why it's called What About Bob? I really don't. Bob must be the crazy one. So he says, so that's what he thinks. Thereby, and why is teaching them an important thing? Because teaching them is the only way that they're going to recognize what their actual reality is by learning about it first, using their intelligence, and then second, experiencing more and more deeply what they have learned, where meditation comes in, you know. Thereby, he generates the love that is after the learning only. He generates the love that is truly a refuge for all living beings. And why? Because love is the wish for the being's happiness. The wish of a being who already, of a Buddha, enlightened being, or a bodhisattva in this case, who already sees that happiness is their deeper nature, and feels happiness more themselves, even maybe not perfect like a Buddha, but still very strongly, then their love for that being is really powerful because it sees that it's very doable that they become free of suffering. Do you follow me? So they're not just sitting there, oh, poor things are suffering, what, nothing I can do about it. There's a lot that can be done about it because it's so easy for them, because if they could open their understanding, it's a bit harder for a cockroach or a god who lives in a bath or some being in the formless realm who has no body and they think they're all isolated there and staying there forever in some samadhi state, you know. How do you reach such a being? It's really difficult. But a human, they're so sensitive and aware of things and self-reflective. So it really is a refuge, that love, because it comes from the goal of the love, which is the happiness, right? And that's what love being, a wish for happiness of the beloved, and the will to the others reaching that happiness is very, very much a refuge, therefore, for that being. The love that is peaceful because free of grasping. It's also peaceful because it can sort of calm itself in perceiving the agony of the world and of the so many beings, the aggregate of all of their suffering and their sweating and groaning. And like in Jefferson's second inaugural address, you know, he talks about the groaning and straining of the old world, you know, Europe, where they're always having wars. He thinks America is going to be free of that, or he'll hope so. You know, in that whole big speech he gave about no foreign entanglements. But it's peaceful because, well, they'll get there, you know, even though they're in a terrible condition now, they will get there. Even dying will not prevent them from getting there. They'll be reborn and they'll get there. So it's peaceful, therefore, because it sees that that's the default reality that will buoy them up, the beings, no matter how badly they behave and therefore how bad a situation they create around themselves, they'll still get there sooner or later. And you know, that loving being, bodhisattva being, will help them no matter what way. The love that is not feverish, because free of addictive passions. I just said passions in those days, which was a long time ago. I might change that now for klesha. You know, because you can't say that delusion or ignorance is a passion. But it was easy to use that. It was a common word in those days, but it isn't really the right word. It's really addiction is the word, you know, for the kleshas, the five or the three, you know, ignorance or misknowledge, hatred and lust or greed, you know, aggression and greed, whatever. So free of addictions, I would say. You must change that. The love that accords with reality, because it is the very same in all three times. Meaning, enlightened being realizes that the present, future is in the present, past is in the present is in the past and the future, and so one's consciousness spreads out infinitely throughout time. And therefore, it's in accordance with reality, because that is reality. Time, that time is this like unchanging, you know, continuum process that never varies, and somehow like a solid flow is an illusion itself. And actually, time, consciousness is accessible to all time. So that's reality. So this love accords with it. And so it's there for the beings in the past and the future. The love that is without, because it comes from reality, this love, you see. The love that is without conflict, because free of the violence of the addictions, of the addictive passions. The love that is non, I want to rehabilitate passion, I think we should. The love that is non-dual, because it is involved neither with the external nor with the internal. So in other words, it's not really limiting itself to those kind of, as if those boundaries were really real. They're there, but they're not really real, and so they're all transparent. There's no shadow in that world of the clear light, of the diamond world of the clear light. The love that is imperturbable, because totally ultimate. So it cannot be disturbed, that love. It's not something that can wear out, because it's always replenished by the nature of reality, by the openness of reality, open-heartedness about reality, so therefore imperturbable. And there's an interesting thing about the clear light of the void that's really quite, I only recently had a kind of feeling about it, which is that it's always an analogous to a diamond. You know, the word vajra comes to mean, it means other things, but one of its important meanings is a diamond. And why it's called a diamond, because diamond is the hardest substance that is known generally in the world, right? You have diamond-bladed saws and things, you know, to saw through stone and things like that. So a diamond is very, very hard. And so, of course, it's a... Oh, hi there, Reza, how are you? And so it's always glossed as unbreakable. It's an energy, it's a field, or even it's infinite, so in a way even it contradicts the meaning of energy. It's inexpressible, but diamond is an analogy for it. And so it's like something solid, kind of. It's like a solid thing, it's unbreakable by anything else. And before that, in ancient Vedic time, the word vajra, one of its other meanings, was a lightning bolt. It was a weapon that the king of the gods held in his hand, Indra. And he shattered things with it, you know, shatter citadels even when they tried to invoke him in war, the Vedic people. And they would ask him to smash a citadel that they were besieging or something coming in from their nomadic thing. The Vedas were not that cute, actually. They were a little rough. And one of Indra's names was Grama Gataka, the breaker of citadels. And so the lightning was thought of as the strongest thing. You could break trees, split rocks, you know, kill someone. Very, very powerful energy. So then, but this infinite energy, you know, although it's often also analogized as space, which is the least solid thing, you know, which you can go through. But on the other hand, it's also, if you were everything, and somehow this is a reality that itself is unbreakable, doesn't disappear. It is the ultimate reality. So then you're seeing everything as a kind of solid thing, the infinite, unbreakable diamond, you know, level of, you know, substance of reality or something like that. Very interesting, the notion of hardness and softness, hardness and openness. And then I thought of how it related. There's a famous scene in the life of Milarepa, where Milarepa, who is a Buddha, not just the Bodhisattva, at that point he's a Buddha in the story, you know, the great Tibetan yogi Milarepa. And he's talking to a geshe, and he's, you know, a PhD, you know, a Tibetan professor. And he says, well, what's your definition of space? And so because he's teasing him a little bit and also trying to get him to overcome pride, his pride of intellect. This geshe, well-trained professor, you know. So he says, well, he gives the Tibetan definition, which is the same as Western one. absence of impenetrability. Double negation, you know. Freedom from impenetrability. So that means you can put something in the space because there's nothing impenetrable in it. So then Milarepa says, oh, he said, oh, you mean like this? And then Milarepa puts his hand through a rock and waves it in around inside the rock. And the Geshe says, no, I mean like, and then he finds his hand in the space. It's totally solid. He can't move it. The air in front of him is totally solid. And it's like he can't move his hand. Oh, that, what do you mean? So that's what you mean. It was the opposite of what the Geshe expected. It was a little trick that Milarepa did. But it was at that plane of where Milarepa, as a Buddha, was aware of this infinite real reality of everything as this kind of diamond, infinite, quiescent, solid energy. So it would be like, so therefore, in other words, when Buddha entered nirvana, let's say, you know, had the experience of entering nirvana, it's again indescribable, but there must have been a moment where he must have felt as if he was becoming paralyzed, like dying, where suddenly your body is just one with everything else, then there's no way of exerting will about what was previously identified by you as your body. So it's like you are one solid continuum with everything else, you know, and everybody else is equally you. So you're identifying with everything in that, so you don't immediately, you have an experience as if you have to let go of your sense of grasping at yourself. Anyway, this is something that occurred to me the other day. Thereby he generates the love that is firm. Oh, there we go. Very good. This is the love that is imperturbable because totally ultimate, like a mountain or something. Thereby he generates the love that is firm. It's high resolve, unbreakable like a diamond. I didn't actually realize this was the next one. That's very good. Firm, it says temba, firm. It's, you know, unbreakable like a diamond. That's like vajra, you know. The love that is pure, purified in its intrinsic nature. So that love, again, in that idea, you see, the Buddha feeling one with all the beings, what is the feeling of love toward, or a bodhisattva coming close to that? The happiness that they will to the beings, which is love, in that perception comes from within the beings themselves. It's like a beautiful thing Dalai Lama once said at a smallish teaching for Indian people in Delhi that he used to give in the spring before which we used to, certain old friends of his could sneak into even though they weren't Indians in the Taj Hotel or something, some conference room. And he was at the end of a teaching of more philosophical type of teaching, he had been asked to give a blessing, kind of, not a full initiation, but kind of like that, introduction to Tara, you know, the miracle-working female bodhisattva, Buddha slash bodhisattva of wonder-working compassion, you know. And he said, and then they were all, you know, very pious and Dalai Lama, you know. So then he says, well, of course, I can't give you any blessings. He says, I don't have any blessings, he says. He's like, uh-oh. He says, the blessing, you have the blessing, he said. And this, that we'll do something now, and we'll say things, and have a little ritual, and you know, I'll say some words and things like that, and that just gives you an excuse to feel that blessing in yourself, but it doesn't come from me. I don't have anything like that. But actually, if you interpret him as a bodhisattva who has this kind of a love, he's seeing the blessing of this wonder-working power welling up in the beings themselves. They have it. You know, he's not giving them some. Like some kind of in-flight refueling, you know, like a tube coming down and blessing is flowing down from the fuel tanker plane flying, you know, which is what I'm afraid a lot of Western people or even Indian and Tibetan people think is what's going on in an initiation, you know. It's like the tanker plane comes and lets down the hose, you know, goes into the tank of the flying plane there and guzzle down some energy. No, that's like silly. Not like that at all. The energy of that being is in each being. We have this energy in our being. But we don't know it, you see. So there is some all different methods and arts and sciences and teachings and things to enable us to open up to what's actually inside ourselves. And an honest teacher, a lot of teachers act like I'm dishing out some initiation, I'm full of blessings and I can give this and that, and just trying to dominate people actually. It's not honest about them. They don't have that honesty. Or maybe they genuinely think they're dishing something out, but they're not actually. Because we have all of it in ourselves, but they're opening, and yet they can skillfully help us open up, a good teacher. But it's so wonderful that the greatest one like that nowadays, I think, on the planet, His Holiness, he steps out of that situation and puts the burden on us to open our minds and do something, not just like tank up, you know, from meeting this sort of enlightened person. I think it's really, really special. He really is so special. I really think so. I'm sorry. I'm just finishing. We're publishing now his life story in a big, giant, 300-page comic book. So I'm kind of into him, you know, thinking about him a lot. So anyway, the love that is pure, purified in its intrinsic nature. That means its emptiness, you know, which is purified in its intrinsic nature of itself, even. The love that is even, its aspirations being equal. You know, it's offered to all beings, you know. It's open because it's just the awareness of their own potential happiness. The Arhat's love that has eliminated its enemy. And this is going on one of the etymologies of the word Arhat, which means a saint, which has two etymologies. One is from the verb arhate, to mean to be worthy, like a worthy. The other one is from arihata. And ari means enemy, and hata means to destroy. So a destroyer of the enemy, and that means destroyer of inner egotism. And it's a sort of inverted, sort of militant thing, you know, where you conquer yourself, you know, you conquer your egotism rather than conquering other people. So in countries where the people were into war, you know, it connects to that. It really means a saint, but a saint is one who has conquered their inner demon or devil of egotistical self-centeredness, you know. The Bodhisattva's love that continuously develops living beings. The Tathagata's love, that means the Buddha, you know, in a transcendent sense, that understands reality. The Buddha's love that causes living beings to awaken from their sleep. The love that is spontaneous because it is fully enlightened spontaneously, because it comes out of being aware of the love within oneself, and which is equal with the love within everybody else, the happiness rather that was in self and everyone else. The love that is enlightenment because it is unity of experience. In other words, that bliss is, everything is made of that bliss. Bliss is everything, life and death and between and whatever it is. The love that is has no presumption because it has eliminated attachment and aversion, of course, because it's fully satisfied. It's a sense of identifying with full satisfaction in any conceivable form or anything, self and other. The love that is great compassion, because it infuses the Mahayana, this means the universal vehicle, with radiance. The love that is never exhausted, because it acknowledges voidness and selflessness. It's aware of voidness and selflessness, so it cannot be exhausted. So because voidness, awareness of voidness and selflessness is bliss. You go, the deepest awareness of voidness or emptiness or selflessness is bliss. When you melt and give it all up and completely, as they say, I think, don't they say that the rappers, when someone comes out, they want you to applaud them, they say, give it up for so-and-so, don't they? They really have a sweet culture in a way. I mean, not some of the awful things they say, some of the terrible stuff about male chauvinist things. The love that is giving because it bestows the gift of Dharma free of the tight fist of a bad teacher. And that's an acharya mushti. And that means a teacher who wants to maintain a sense of superiority over the student and therefore doesn't reveal whatever they think they know to the student, holds something back. Which Buddha always says, I never held back. He picks up a bunch of leaves in the Theravada thing. I don't know if we read that passage. He picks up a bunch of leaves in a forest and he says, here's my all that I've taught you, it's this bunch of leaves, and I didn't hold a single leaf back, he said. But on the other hand, the teachings of in the universe are as many as all the leaves in the whole forest. He says like that to them. Because he has no tight fist of a bad teacher. And that's why the challenge is to to realize that it's okay, you can fix it if it's making dingy noises. That's all right. We won't accuse you of being hypnotized by your iPhone, like the younger generation. I lost track. And their exalted knowledge is what love is giving, because it bestows the gift of Dharma free of the tight fist of a bad teacher. That's right, but it was. Oh yeah, so therefore Buddha is teaching Tantra, highest Tantra. He's already teaching that in Theravada Buddhism. I didn't take this with the guy I did the show with today, Dan Harris. It would be too much for them. But I insist that you'll see. When we go into Tantra later, in the next round, in this course, when we go into Tantra, what is called the subtle mind and the clear light, the four layers of the subtle and super subtle mind, these four lights, if you flip them this way, they are exactly the same as the four formless realms. And nobody has pointed that out. And one geisha got so mad with me one time when I said, well, yes, Tantra is secret, but he taught it to everybody. They just didn't get it. And he didn't need them to get it. He was just planting the seed that later they'll get it. But he taught them, totally. And then he was so angry. No, it's secret. It's only for people who are prepared. Can't say that. Because I was saying that, you know, Tibetans have a thing, and the late Indian Buddhism had a thing that sutra and tantra are mutually intercoordinated. You know, they're mutually, sungjuk meaning, they're paired and coordinated. So it's not like tantra replaces, you know, sutra teachings, exoteric teachings. It's coordinated with it. So which they interpret as meaning that the sutras are all compressed in the tantras. So the tantra fulfills the meanings of the sutras. So I said, but you can't say that in real coordination. If you say that, then tantra's in the sutras too. And then not only in Mahayana sutras, it's in all the sutras. It's there. And then they argue. And then I said, okay, you go downtown and you see a bag, and for whatever you want, a bag of manure, and you grab it to go and fertilize your field to grow something, grow your flowers in your garden, I said. And there's a diamond inside that manure. But you think it's just manure, I said. So you don't know the diamond is in there. So in that sense, the diamond presence in there is a secret. But when you pick up the bag, you're also holding the diamond in the middle of the manure. I said, you just don't know it's there, right? So this guy gave you some bag of manure to start with, and then there's a diamond in there, which you didn't find. He was very upset with me. Oh, you can't say that. But I swear, nobody did say it. Of course, great masters like Tsongkhapa, Longchenpa, Sakyapanita, I'm sure they knew that. They knew the connection between the subtle, four subtle disembodied planes, where the mind is only has the super subtle, subtle energy body. And if you think about those four, but I'll talk about that later, in another time. So, the love that is giving, the love that is morality, because it improves immoral beings. The love that is tolerance, because these are the paramitas, you know, giving, morality, tolerance, because it protects both self and others. The love that is effort, because it takes responsibility for all beings. Effort means true zeal or effort or heroic effort, virya, you know, means that that is again how you enter Tantra. When the Bodhisattva enters Tantric practice, is not because I don't have the patience and I wouldn't want to be here for three incalculable aeons of lifetimes to help beings. I'm too bored with that. I want to immediately do something that will leap into Buddhahood right away. That's not the reason. The reason is, Bodhisattva is perfectly happy to take as many lives as there are beings, which is an infinite number. But the point is, it's not happy to leave the beings for an endlessly long time in their state of suffering if they can develop a higher ability to help them, a more magical knowledge, like to understand the evolution toward the Buddha embodiments, the magical, kind of magical level of Buddha embodiments. So they want to accelerate reaching that for the sake of the beings. Do you follow? They don't want to take, like, okay, well, I'll get there later, so, you know, we'll all get there one day. It's like, one, that's fine with him because, or her, that bodhisattva, because they're not suffering that much because they have this dual vision of emptiness and bliss and of the two realities as interfolded. But the other beings don't. So they can't, they it becomes unbearable to them that the other beings, their mother beings, have to wait for these three incalculable series of lifetimes. So then, oh, there's a super accelerated teaching. I'm ready for that. Let's do it. Let's accelerate. But the acceleration is 1, 7, 3, 7, 16 lifetimes. It's a short time compared with billions of them. As you know, even if it's 15 lifetimes, it's still short. Right? That's accelerating. And then, now I don't want to jump too much ahead, but that's exactly what it is. Taking responsibility for all beings means, it's like in the Christian context, it's like that mystic who wrote that book called Imitatio Christi. Not just let Jesus do it for you, but you join Jesus in the work. You work, you do it. You be a Messiah, you know. There is a feminine for Messiah in English. And it doesn't look good on paper, but it's, you can pronounce it Messias. But on paper, it looks like Messias. It's like terrible. M-E-S-S-I-E-S-S. Almost like Messiest. But that's not fair. Men are messier. I know that. So, Messias. That's what taking responsibility means. Becoming, I'll save them, you know. Even if you can't, the wish to do so is where the bodhisattva vow comes from. So that's why it's, that love is effort. Taking responsibility for all beings. The love that is contemplation, because it refrains from indulgence in tastes. So, you know, it's even-minded about things. It's not, oh, I like this, I don't like that. The love that is wisdom, because it causes attainment at the proper time. And that's a very important thing, not to attain some kind of state of aloofness, some sort of excessive focus on the emptiness side, before you have moved the compassion to a certain degree. That's what's called not to have an attainment at the proper time. The love that is liberative art, because it shows the way everywhere. I used to use technique in the printed version, those of you who have that. Now I like to use art for upaya. So it's liberative art because it shows the way everywhere. The love, and it can, because it sees the goal as everywhere, actually. The love that is without formality, because it is pure in motivation. The love that is without deviation, because it acts from decisive motivation. The love that is high resolve, adhyashaya, that's sort of like messianic resolve, you could translate that, because it is without addictions. The love that is without deceit, because it is not artificial. And the love that is happiness, it's the happiness itself, the true bliss, you know, because it introduces living beings to the happiness of the Buddha. Such, Manjushri, is the great love of a bodhisattva. Truly great. The reason I read this to you and made commentary on the whole thing is, this is why sutras are so awesome. And I think I mentioned this before, but I just want to mention it again. That, you know, in the threefold thing about Buddhism, the verbal or textual Buddhism, you know, the verbal Buddhism, you have the Vinaya, Sutra, and Abhidharma. And Vinaya, and then in the practical Buddhism or realizational Buddhism, you have, you know, Adhigama. This is Agama, and this is Adhigama. And realizational Buddhism, corresponding to Vinaya, you have ethics, transcendent or higher ethics. Corresponding to Sutra, you have higher meditation or higher mind. Corresponding to Abhidharma, you have higher wisdom. So Abhidharma is any analytical thing that helps you develop penetrating wisdom. But Sutra, in other words, listening to the Buddha speech, or listening to Vimalakirti, who turns out to be an emanation of a Buddha from another universe, right? You all read it. I think most of you read it, the whole thing, right? So he's the emanation of Akshobhya from another universe in eastern direction, beyond universes as many as grains of sand in 62 Ganges riverbeds, which is quite a few grains of sand, and way beyond. And anyway, so in other words, when you read it, even though it seems like it's maybe a bunch of hyperbole or some of the things, kind of nice, but and it sounds good also in Sanskrit or Tibetan, but actually each one is packed with a kind of the seed of a meditative state. So, you know, if you can meditate this passage on love, and you think about love that is happiness because it introduces living beings to the happiness of the Buddha. So what does that mean? When I love someone, is it out of my happiness? Is it out of seeing their potential happiness? Which gives me a strong encouragement of whatever it takes to be artful and to be careful and to be considerate about allowing their own happiness to emerge from within themselves, etc. And you can meditate on it. Let's meditate on that. Let's meditate on that. I don't let you meditate enough. Talk too much. Okay, meditate. So in your meditation, you imagine you're a bodhisattva. I think probably most of you are definitely bodhisattvas anyway. Whether you formally, you don't have to be a Buddhist to be a bodhisattva, by the way. And just have to decide that you're going to take care of everyone. As Krishna Das says, quoting his teacher, who was Hindu, Nimkaroli Baba, love everyone. So, think about how it might be that when you feel real happiness within, kind of bliss that seems to be unconnected from some possession, some experience that you possessed or, you know, owned, made your own, and it seems to be unconnected from any, therefore, subject-object interaction, and seems to come sort of from nowhere, from everywhere, from within you, from outside, just a sense of just everything infused with it. You felt infused with everything, or you feel that. And it's just flows up inside you and makes you, and just flows out of you toward everyone and everything that you can think of. And in a way, kind of, it seems to resonate with some kind of glimmer of beauty. You can see even in some miserable, neurotic, narcissistic, psychotic candidate for president, no, person. and you just feel so relaxed about it because although in one way it's a flowing up within you, in one way it's flowing out without you, outside of you, but on the other hand, that's not an issue because it seems to already be outside of you everywhere and infusing everything, like a permeating everything. And then, but of course, then if you, within that feeling, if you bring to mind a being who, well, when you sort of think of any being, when you're feeling this way, you find a glimmer of beauty in anything or anyone, something amazing about it seems to you when you're in that mood, you know, like Gene Kelly dancing in the rain sort of thing. Nothing perturbs it. This thing is so strong in you that and outside of you, beyond being contained within or outside, gives itself away and gets stronger by giving itself away. So really just rest in that feeling. And don't worry if you don't see it. It's not a bright white light. It's not a state of feeling everything is all glistening in white light. It's not a state of something, everything shining like brilliant sunshine. It's not a state of just sort of unconsciously not differentiating yourself from things and being in kind of soothing darkness. It's rather a state of feeling transparent and everything seeming transparent to you. And then you can play in your meditation with the idea that imagining this, you'll maybe feel a hint of feeling, kind of a natural betterness, happiness, blissfulness, contentment. And then note that when you sort of focus on it, like seize it with your mind, oh yeah, okay, there I have a feeling. That kind of seems to squelch it. And when you sort of feel it and just let it be there without kind of trying to possess it, it increases. When you let go of it, it becomes more. When you try to take hold of it, it becomes less. It shuts it off. So you see, you realize it is generosity, it is exactness, it isn't like a desperate radiating some kind of forceful bliss at people or something like that. Isn't that at all? So you just imaginatively dwell in that, and you won't feel frustrated if it's difficult when you realize that, when you think that what you're imagining is actually more real than what you are habitually perceiving involving your habitual imagination. You're sort of going against your habitual imagination of it, things, everything being inadequate and imperfect. And actually, there's some testimony of enlightened beings that what you're imagining is what is actually there, rather than what you're used to feeling is there. That helps you not feel frustrated when your mind veers off trying to imagine that. And what a great Buddhist yogi would do, or yogini, would memorize a passage in Tibetan or Sanskrit or even English of the, say, the Vimalakirti Sutra or Prajnaparamita Sutra, Avatamsaka Sutra, just a few lines maybe. And then because you memorized it, you can let it run through your mind and see where does that bliss feeling that you're imagining, and therefore in a way having a tiny taste of it through simulating it by imagination, how that connects to love, what is called love, for a beloved, wanting the beloved to be happy, seeing the beloved potentially happy. And that's the love that is firm, its nature unbreakable like a diamond. Because there's, in a way, that beloved that cannot resist the happiness that is its own deepest nature. It's freedom in nirvana. It's freedom in clear light of the void. It's freedom in the clear light of freedom. Voidness can also be translated simply as freedom. Some freedom beyond their normal sense of identity, of being bound in their separated, alienated skin. So then toy with that idea. How does that affect your what emanates from you emotionally as an emotion of love? And then all of those things we read. Because that passage then, if one reads it in this meditative way with your whole body and mind, then you enter into the samadhi of Vimalakirti, of Buddha, of Akshobhya Buddha. Akshobhya, like it sounds, means unshakable, unperturbable. Nothing shakes him. He's not shook up by anything. Because he's one with this reality. One with Shakyamuni, actually, too. Same being. Okay, ding. I don't want to go too long or you might fall asleep. Actually, when you fall asleep, you know, you're seeking that kind of happiness, that bliss, because you're tired and it's a big struggle getting through the day, doing all the things and dealing with all this up and down, in and out. And so you're heading toward merging with clear light, and you know, and the reason you rested when you wake from sleep and deep sleep is because you mixed the deep sleep, you got past the darkness image that you have in your mind, because you go through a phase of darkness when you lose consciousness, so to speak. You give up, you give it up into being unconscious. But actually, that place is not a resting point, that's just a threshold of clear light, you know. And the reason we can't to clear light, we can't see clear light, is because we're constantly seeking things that we experience as objects that are outside of our subjectivity. And clear light is never an object outside of your subjectivity, because your subjectivity is just as clear light as your any object. So you have to, you can only melt into it, something like that. And the melting has a threshold of unconsciousness. But you don't stick in unconsciousness. But it's subtle and hard to do a little bit. But it's very important to understand it ahead of time. Okay, so then after they get into the samadhi, since realistic samadhi corresponds to what is in the sutra, right? And we are, after all, still working with sutras. And since that is the case, Then Manjushri intervenes with this marvelous exchange, and this exchange is what blew the mind of Sung Jiao in ancient China. He said, Manjushri then presses Vimalakirti after this passage on the great love of the Bodhisattva. He says, Manjushri, what is the great compassion of a Bodhisattva? And Vimalakirti says, it is the giving of all accumulated roots of virtue to all living beings. So this is so beautiful, because the idea of a root of virtue is sort of an agricultural simile for accumulating, you know, strength of positivity in your being by doing positive things. You know, you get these roots of virtue, you know, and they will grow the flowers of Buddhahood, of positive embodiment, of positive future lives, and so forth, positive mental states. But the way they really develop strongly is when you give them away as you get them. And that's your compassion, because the compassion means that they're shared immediately with other beings. And what Taratoko, our great teacher Taratoko, the late Taratoko, was so wonderful. He said once, I think he said several times, but one time he said, that it's like investing. When you do something good and virtuous, if you sort of take it, I did a good thing, I did that, I did it, you're putting it into your own kind of sense of possession, which is unstable. It's like putting it under your mattress. You know, putting your money under your mattress, it might be a fire. You know, your landlord might kick you out of your house, whatever. You're vulnerable. You might lose it. It might mix with some kind of egotistical appropriation. But if, as you do something really good, you immediately share it with beings. You say, I dedicate what I did for the sake of all beings. You know, to become a Buddha for the sake of all beings. But in a way, you give it away to all beings. Right, like you, it's like, then you're investing that in the universe, in the cosmos, and you change the whole cosmos. And since it's invested in many places, it's like hedging your bets. And if one thing goes down, it won't lose it. So it's much more strategic. It's really brilliant the way he said that. If you just take it here, then you could lose it, because you could be deprived of it. You could deprive yourself of it. But if you give it away, you know, then it's safe with all the beings, and then nobody can get all of them, you know. So even somebody kills a lot of them in some horrible nuclear explosion or horrible poisoning or whatever it might be, they'll all be reborn and they'll continue on, you know. What is the great joy of the bodhisattva, he says? It is to be joyful and without regret in giving. So, you know, actually, this, you know, on top of love, remember he's, in a way, this is also resonating with the four immeasurables. You remember the four immeasurables? Does everybody remember them? The four contemplative states that constitute the realm of pure form or pure matter. You know, the Brahma-bodied realms, where there's 16 different heavens, different Brahma-bodied heavens, where there's many, it's a highly populated sort of thing. So the four, but those 16 are divided in 3, 3, 3, and 7, heaven layers, sort of. And the beings there don't have real estate, they don't have ordinary boundaried bodies, they have energy bodies and so forth, they're Brahma bodies. There are many beings, many gods in those areas. But the four immeasurables are immeasurable love, immeasurable compassion, immeasurable joy, and immeasurable equanimity. And they're called the four dhyanas, the four contemplative states also, and the four apramananis, the four immeasurable states, right? And they are very important meditatively, and they're marvelous. When you achieve any of them, they fit up in one another. In other words, when you move from the love to the compassion, you bring the love with you into the compassion. When you move from the combined love and compassion into the joy, you bring them both with you into the joy. So it's a triple thing. When you bring them into the highest one, which is equanimity, which takes you to the boundary of the formless realm of infinite space, but you're still, you have some kind of vast, like Brahma-type body, energy body. When that's equanimity plus joy plus compassion plus love. You know, that's where Brahma, the high god Brahma, lives. In the seventh level of that. And that's where the Buddha lands all are, in Abhidharma, in sort of Buddhist science, Buddhist cosmology. So what is the great joy? It's to be joyful and without regret in giving. In other words, giving one's love, giving one's wish to free others from suffering, one's will to their freedom from suffering, which is the love and compassion, that circuit then creates this joyful thing of that's happening, and there's no regret about just letting it all go type of thing. And what is the equanimity of the bodhisattva? It is what benefits both self and others. So this is allowing oneself to be included in this joy and compassion and love. So he sort of gives the four measurable states in that. It is what benefits both, which are but yet states of a still embodied being, not a disembodied being. So to what should one, so then Manushri takes a different tack, and he says, to what should one resort when terrified by fear of life? What does samsara put that? That's a mistake. I like life. I think they edited, some guy was trying to get me to put samsara back in there. I think fear of life is good. People are afraid of life, especially after they've had lots of slings and arrows and blows and sufferings and tragedies. They're afraid of it. So to what should one resort when terrified by fear of life? Manjushri, a bodhisattva who's terrified by fear of life, again, they're trying to get me to say samsara, I won't say it. You know, people think they make a big deal translator and they repeat a word that nobody knows what it means. Why do they think that's translating? A bodhisattva who is terrified by fear of life should resort to the magnanimity of the Buddha. That is the great generosity of enlightened beings. And Buddhas, you know, there's infinite numbers of them, and each one is infinite, so it's really very magnanimous. Where should he or she who wishes to resort to the magnanimity of the Buddha take his or her stand? He should live for the liberation of all beings. Live for freedom, just like W. Someone in Texas. What should he who wishes to liberate all living beings do? He should liberate them from their addictions or addictive passions. I really have to change this. I don't care if they like it or not. Addictions. How should he or she who wishes to eliminate addictions apply him or herself? She should apply herself appropriately. or realistically, maybe I would say now, how should she apply herself to apply herself appropriately or realistically? You know, yatavat, it's a Sanskrit. He should apply himself to productionlessness and to destructionlessness. That's like, those are synonyms of nirvana, of the uncreated. That's what you apply yourself to. That's being realistic, you know, it's going to ultimate reality. What is not produced and what is not destroyed? Evil is not produced and good is not destroyed. Because good is the unproduced, uncreated nature of reality itself. The nirvana is the real, the really real. Though it's not destroyed, it can't be destroyed because it's not produced. And evil is not produced because evil is only failing to understand reality. And in a way, it's not, that is ultimately not produced. It is relatively produced, but not ultimately. What is the root of good and evil? This is a very surprising one. He says, Pinda. Do I have a footnote? 187. Pinda. Oh. Chitsok, yeah. Chitsok Satkaya. And that's very controversial, but anyway, they've accepted my. Materiality is the root of good and evil. And materiality meaning somehow that these relative things, like the body, Satkaya sort of means a perishable body. Perishable body is one way of understanding Satkaya, or a really real body. So thinking of a material thing as really real. So that's an intrinsic reality habit, like this table, this computer is really real, it's a material thing. And so believing that this is an intrinsically real thing, misinvesting a sense of massive absoluteness or facticity in this relative thing, rather than seeing it as a flow, as part of a flow, even a seemingly solid thing, making it into a material thing, is the root of good and evil. And what is the root of materiality? Desire is the root of materiality. So I want to cling to this, and this kind of desire means some feeling of inadequacy about something, so I want to own this table, I want to own the computer, whatever it is. And what is the root of desire and attachment? Unreal construction is the root of desire, which in a way is a kind of synonym of ignorance, actually. Unreal construction means thinking that my conceptual sense of that pillar or the floor, which is really unreal, it's my imposition on a reality that is unspeakable and indescribable, whatever that is. You know, it's seen from all infinite numbers of angles. But then I attach to that, I think that's what it really is, corresponding to my concept for it. That's what unreal mental construction, I really could have said. It's the root of desire. What is the root of unreal construction? The false concept is its root. What is the root of the false concept? Baselessness. It has no root. It's just something made up with our ignorance, out of our ignorance. So he says baselessness, which is like emptiness. What is the root of baselessness? Manjushri presses, Manjushri, when something is baseless, how can it have any root? Therefore, all things stand on the root which is baseless. Ta-da! It's like that praise in the beginning of the first chapter, remember when the young yapi said to Buddha, you know, you never attached to any sign and you are marvelous, but you stand nowhere. Remember he said that. In other words, the Buddha, although he seems to be a separated body standing in a particular place, actually he is everything. He experiences himself as everything, so he's not really, he's unlocated in that sense of being everywhere. So then there's this, then they begin the thing. I didn't mean to go into all that detail, but I'm very glad I did. Because I'm trying to guide you through it, where when you read these things yourself, slowly and patiently, not necessarily only this one, but others, as you become, you know, you realize that it's not just, your mind doesn't just skitter over it, oh yeah, okay, I read that page, you know. It's like you sort of go in and find, and the samadhi comes out of the words and the sentences. And you enter into that samadhi by reading. When you read, you enter a meditation. Anyway, when you read like novel, like Grisham, you know, the whatever, and whatever novel you read, you are meditating in the world that it takes you into. And so you have to be careful what you read and meditate on, in fact. So anyway, she starts teasing him about how he's not in nirvana and many things. Then he asks her, I wanted to do this because this is so lovely. Because this is what we Tibet House should be. It's what everyone's home should be like. It's what Menla is like, Tibet House's retreat center. We aspire to what the goddess says Vimalakirti's house is like. And I didn't read this to you, I'm sure. So Shariputra, then, you know, after he always changes the subject, after she gives him a teaching about how, you know, he's in nirvana and whatever, he's not in nirvana any more than anybody else and so on. So then he asks her, well, are you a member of the individual vehicle, or are you a member of the great vehicle? Are you in the disciple vehicle, the solitary vehicle? Those are two types of the individual vehicle. Or in the great vehicle, that's the Mahayana, universal vehicle. She says, well, I can be in the disciple vehicle when I teach it to those who need it, says the goddess of wisdom. And I can be along to the solitary sage vehicle when I teach the 12 links of dependent origination to those who need them. And since I never abandon the great compassion, I belong to the great vehicle, as all need that teaching to attain ultimate liberation, she says. So then she says, I've been in this house for a long time, Vimalakirti's house, she says, but which is redolent with the perfume of the virtues of the Buddha excellences, and you don't smell in there the perfume of the disciples and the solitary sages. But all the creatures, the gods, and all the different gods and dragons and different things she mentions, who live in this house, hear the Dharma from the mouth of this holy man, and enticed by the perfume, I think I would change that to noble man, and enticed by the perfume of the virtues of the Buddha qualities, proceed to conceive the spirit of enlightenment. So I have been in this house for 12 years, she says. But I don't know why she says 12, but she just says that. Sariputra, 8 strange and wonderful things manifest them constantly in this house. What are the 8? I do love this. And you should think about this is how you want your own home to be, okay? Call your decorator. Okay? A light of golden hue shines here constantly, so bright that it is hard to distinguish day and night, and neither the moon nor the sun shines here distinctly. That is the first wonder of this house. Furthermore, Reverend Shariputra, whoever enters this house is no longer troubled by his or her addictive passions from the moment he or she is within. That is the second strange and wonderful thing. So just being, setting foot in it, they feel better. You know, there should be somehow something that makes them, like in Tibetan houses, they have Om Mani Padme Hum on the threshold, or what's that called, the door jamb, you know? Some mantra, like presence of the infant Buddhas of compassion, you know? Om Mani Padme Hum. Or they have some icon or some symbol, some positive thing. The lucky man, sometimes they have, you know, with holding jewels in his mouth, you know? They'll have that on the gate of a monastery. And like Jewish households have a little mezuzah. I think that's like a lucky thing. Everyone has things like that. So it doesn't have to be Buddhist. But, you know, there should be some lucky thing so that you should have a visualization that anyone who enters here will feel immediately free of, like, feeling they need a lot of things and they're, like, all desperate and dissatisfied or whatever. You know, that's, like, the first one. Second wonderful thing. It's all, there's a golden light there all the time. You have to get some sort of special kind of light bulb. Okay? Third thing. This house is never forsaken by Chakra, Brahma, the Lokapalas, and the Bodhisattvas, from all the other Buddha fields. That is the third strange and wonderful thing. So Zeus, the Chakra, means Indra, which means the god of Olympus. And Brahma is like Jehovah or the high god, you know, who people think is the creator, but he says he isn't in the Buddhist thing, but he's still really powerful, most powerful god in a particular universe. It's called the Brahma of the universe. And Lokapalas. So don't tell me Buddhists are atheistic. He's also very present in the Theravada scriptures, as we saw when we read them. So the Lokapalas mean all kind of like guardian deities of the four directions, and they have all kinds of people like that. And the Bodhisattvas from all the other Buddha fields, so all kinds of angels. Like that is the third strange and wonderful thing. They're like all around the house. You know? So furthermore, Reverend Shariputra, this house is never empty of the sounds of the Dharma, the discourse on the six transcendences, and the discourses of the irreversible wheel of the Dharma. That is the fourth strange and wonderful thing. So somehow, the CD player is constantly reciting the sutras. And it's just kind of a hum in the background. And so one's mind naturally turns, or some mantras or something, Om Tari Tu Tari Tu Re. Krishna Das is on there. Om Tari Tu Tari Tu Re Swaha. He was singing that last night somewhere. Furthermore, Reverend Shariputra, in this house, one always hears the rhythms, songs, and music of gods and humans. And from this music constantly resounds the sound of the infinite Dharma of the Buddha. That is the fifth strange and wonderful thing. And what is the sound of the infinite Dharma of the Buddha? It's kind of like that inner hum. It's not tinnitus. It's the inner hum, what they call the anahata shabda, the unstruck sound that is the sound of freedom, the sound of emptiness. It's kind of a hum. Sometimes some beings who are very attached to their limited state, it feels like a roar. Sometimes it's called the lion's roar. But to a being that wants to open, that is generous, that is able to go with the flow, it's like a wonderful hum. Like hum, like om, actually. It's like a permanent om. That is the fifth strange and wonderful thing. Furthermore, Reverend Sariputra, in this house, there are also, that's the sound system. You have a lighting system, you have a sound system. In this house, there are always four inexhaustible treasures, replete with all kinds of jewels, which never decrease, although all the poor and the wretched may partake of them to their satisfaction. So there's some kind of, you know, revolving fund of generosity in the house, you know, ideally. You know, that is the sixth strange and wonderful thing. So that the treasure, of course, is the treasure of generosity that is inexhaustible, actually, which then draws to itself. Now, this relates to Max Weber and my argument that the root of true capitalism actually is generosity and self-restraint. You know, consuming less than you produce, and therefore having, you know, surplus to give and invest in other beings and the future and so forth. That's really what capitalism is about, not rapacious exploiting people and so forth. It really is based on generosity, then I argue, I insist, I'm sorry. That because of laissez-faire piratical capitalism, then people get the wrong idea about it. But actually the true root of it is the creativity that comes from wanting to give a good thing to the client and the customer, and then they're going to like that, and therefore there'll be this circle of increasing wealth. And it's the difference between the merchant class and the military class. As I used to say, the original form of gaining wealth in exploitive and rapacious manner is military. You go and conquer Troy and like take their stores of silk and stuff and then burn the place down. So you don't have to make a deal. You don't have to bring some olives and retsina and things to trade from Greece. You just take everything. But the problem is, when you do that, you've killed your customer. they're not there to produce something next year for you to make a deal with. Do you follow me? So that's not a deal. That's just rapacity. It's piracy. You know, exchange, you know, commerce, the merchant classes in Buddha's time were into exchange and growing everyone's wealth by mutual satisfaction. You know, that's really the root of it, actually. Tremendous wealth, too. The guy who gave Buddha his first monastery, there was a particular, the most beautiful garden in that city, outside that city, the most beautiful grove belonged to a prince called Prince Jeta. And he loved that garden. He had parties there. It was like he had pavilions. He wasn't going to give up that part, that garden. So this merchant went there and said, Anathapindada, said to him, I want to buy your garden. Sell me your garden. I want it for the Buddha and his disciples. I'm going to make him an abode here. And the guy said, oh, come on. This garden, you'd have to cover it with gold coins, every inch of its surface. Which was meaning, no, I'm not selling it. He said, witnessed, sign. And he shook his hand and poured water over their hands, which is the Indian ritual of sealing a contract. So somehow you wash your hand with the other person, you know. And then the prince was like, oh, no, you know, like, well, okay, get busy, you know. Doubting that merchant would do that. So the merchant proceeded to bring cartloads and cartloads of gold coins, completely covered the whole thing. And when he got down to the last 10 square meters, the prince said, "All right, I donate these 10 meters. I want some of the merit of creating the thing." And he gave up the Jetavana Grove, which there's still a ruin in the Jetavana Grove, actually, outside of Shravasti. Wonderful place, one of the loveliest ruins, pilgrimage ruins in India, Shravasti. But it's just a ruin, but the vibe of the place is incredible. It really is. So anyway, that's the sixth strange and wonderful thing. "Furthermore, Reverend Shariputra, at the wish of this good man, to this house come the innumerable Tathagatas of the 10 directions, such as the Tathagatas Shakyamuni, Amitabha, Akshobhya, Ratnasri, Ratnachahi, Ratnachandra, Ratnavyuha, Dushprasaha, Sarvartha Siddha, Prabhutaratna, and Simhanada Nadi, Simhagosha," and so forth. "And when they come, they teach the door of the Dharma called the secrets of the Tathagatas." That's Tantra. That's like the mandala of these Buddhas, you know, all the naming there, all the archetype Buddhas, you know, Vairochana, Akshobhya, Ratnasambhava, Amoghasiddhi, and Akshobhya. And they're right there in Mahayana, it's mention of Tantra. So you have to have some mandala in your house. That's harder for the decorator to deal with that. Because mandalas are really not just diagrams on the wall, they're three-dimensional things. They're palaces, you know. Finally, Reverend Shariputra, all the splendors of the abodes of the gods and all the splendors of the fields of the Buddhas shine forth in this house. This is the eighth strange and wonderful thing. Reverend Shariputra, these eight strange and wonderful things are seen in this house. Who then, seeing such inconceivable things, would believe the teaching of the disciples?" In other words, that the relative world is inevitably hopeless, she means. There can't be any beauty in it, it's just really terrible. And the only thing you have to do is get out of it and you'll get to nirvana, which actually has a slightly nihilistic quality to escapist, let's say, or nihilistic quality to it. It would be intelligent, of course, if that was really a fact, that there was a place outside the world that you could reach where you would have eternal happiness, that would be fine. But actually, if it's outside the world, it's not absolute, because it's excluded from, it's like infinity. It can't be infinite and be excluded from some place, right? If it's excluded from somewhere, it means it's relative. So therefore, it's not the absolute. It's not the uncreated, you know, the beginningless, you know, which nirvana is, right? That's only logical. When Dan Harris asked me earlier today, "What's your evidence for all this?" I said, "Well, the evidence is that the infinite cannot be excluded, logically. It's here. So we're in the infinite right away. We don't know that. We think, I'm not me, that's not me. But it's all infinite. So... don't you think? What do you think?" My friend Peter Berger, did I tell you the story about him? Peter Berger, great sociologist, actually. I think he's still alive. I hope he's not the late Peter Berger. I don't think so. I would have heard about him. I have lost touch with him for a decade or so. He lives in Boston. And he and his wife both are great sociologists. I'm sure they're retired by now. They're a bit older than me. And he got very interested in Buddhism. And years ago, when I used to live in Massachusetts and teach there, 35 years ago, and he was so brilliant, you know, he is the greatest modern incarnation of Max Weber, if there ever was, really brilliant sociologist. And he was so intrigued about Buddhism, it's really something, but he's a little nervous about it, about this sort of expandedness, infinity, self and other, the quality of self and other, all of these things. But he was intrigued. And then at some symposium or seminar that I held at Amherst, he came from Boston, from BU to attend, and he met there a woman from New York who had a yoga class, kind of, but she taught also, she was initiated by some lamas, and she taught a kind of white Tara meditation. And she looked a little like white Tara, she was quite marvelous. Elizabeth something, I lost touch with her too, but years ago. But one day I was in a class, actually, and I was called out on an emergency basis. It was not a college class, it was a Dharma class somewhere. So interrupted, and someone brought me the phone, and I stepped out. And he was on the phone. It was in the evening. It's an evening class. And he says, "Bob, I'm calling from a phone booth in the village." It was in New York. I said, "Okay, Peter, what's up?" He said, "I went to Elizabeth's class on the White Tara." He said, and I had to come and call you because I could feel my boundaries slipping. What should I do?" And I said, "Peter, you're in a phone booth. You're okay. You know, feel the walls of the phone booth. You know, like, relax, you know. You can't slip. It's just, you're going to relax. You're relaxing a little. Just relax. It'll be fine. Nobody's going to do anything to you. Nothing." And he was just really, I talked him down, you know. And I said, "You should really go back. Don't run away from that. Go back and sit there. There's nothing, no one's going to molest you. They're just meditating. You're meditating. You're discovering something about yourself that you can feel a little relaxed and a little expanded and identify with what's around you." And, "Well, I don't know." My boundaries were slipping. So this person is a genius. No, he wrote the most extraordinary books. If you ever want to read, like, you know, sociology of religion books, The Homeless Mind, you know, The Pyramids of Sacrifice, The Sacred Canopy. I mean, he's really brilliant, really smart person. And you can see he has a deep inner thing, but obviously he's not completely connected to his own inner feeling, you know. Anyway, but imagine this house. This is my ideal of a house, really. That's why I love Doctor Who. You should go watch Doctor Who. Doctor Who's house is a little bit like that. Time Lord, you know. He like travels everywhere in time. Jingyi, do you know Doctor Who? You have watched Doctor Who? Oh, only one time? Oh, there are 9 Doctor Who's. They each one has 9 lives because they have 2 hearts. And they're, you know, there's some of the actors who play, some of them are more fun than others. But you can find them probably all on YouTube or something, you know. And you have to sort of get into it because they're usually multi-session, maybe 8-10 session adventures that he has, you know, when he goes in a particular time. Some of them are kind of boring and silly. The old ones were very low-tech. And the arch enemy, one of the arch enemies is these computers who have human brains stuck inside them called the Daleks, and who are very far out computers, and they can time travel and many things, and they hate him and they want to get him, you know. But in the older ones, they look like a vacuum cleaner, kind of. Vacuum cleaners going berserk. And they would go around going, "Exterminate, exterminate, exterminate." They would go around like that, these vacuum cleaners. But then later ones, they're very high-tech, you know, and they levitate and so on. The BBC, longest sci-fi thing in the world, TV world. Really fun, Doctor Who. I really like it. Okay. So anyway, that's that part of the Vimalakirti. Isn't that fun, though? You know, people find, you know, the Tibetans, they recite these on holidays, these sutras. They sort of go into the field that the sutras create. And they read them on holidays and things, but they don't actually study them because they think that it's better to study Shantideva's book or some organized treatise that takes you up through steps of meditation that are sort of more generally applicable. Because these were all taught in specific contexts. And then they have this idea that the ancient people in Buddha's time were so lucky because Buddha was there, and so they could just go right off into samadhi and attain insights listening to Buddha. And that's, of course, true. But on the other hand, like at the end of the Vimalakirti, he says, you know, and this, since this is our last session on sutras, I can jump to that. He says, you know, anybody who reads this sutra, he says, the 4 guardian kings say, you know, anybody who reads this sutra, wait, where is it? He entrusts the sutra to Maitreya, antecedence and transmission of the holy Dharma. Then Chakra, the king of the gods, said to the Buddha, Lord, formerly I have heard from the Tathagata and from Manjushri, the crown prince of wisdom, many hundreds of thousands of teachings of the Dharma, because he's a god, you know. So he lives a long time. They're never permanent or eternal, the gods, but they live a long time. But I have never before heard a teaching of the Dharma as remarkable as this instruction in the entrance into the method of inconceivable transformations. Lord, those living beings who, having heard this teaching of the Dharma, accept it, remember it, read it, and understand it deeply, will be without a doubt true vessels of the Dharma. There is no need to mention those who apply themselves to the yoga of meditation upon it. Upon, like, this is just a small little Vimalakirti Sutra compared to this other one. They will cut off all the possibility of unhappy lives, will open their way to all fortunate lives, will always be looked after by all Buddhas, will always overcome all adversaries, and will always conquer all devils. They will practice the path of the Bodhisattvas, will take their places upon the seat of enlightenment under the Bodhi tree in a particular universe, and will have truly entered the domain of the Tathagatas, of the enlightened beings. Lord, the noble sons and daughters who will teach and practice this exposition of the Dharma will be honored and served by me and my followers. So Zeus is going to support anybody who really gets into it. To the villages, towns, cities, states, kingdoms, and capitals wherein this teaching of the Dharma will be applied, taught, and demonstrated, I and my followers will come to hear the Dharma. I will inspire the unbelieving with faith, and I will guarantee my help and protection to those who believe and uphold the Dharma. At these words, the Buddha said to Shakra, the king of the gods, excellent, excellent king of the gods, the Tathagata rejoices in your good words. King of gods, the enlightenment of the Buddhas of the past, present, and future is expressed in this discourse of Dharma. Therefore, king of gods, when noble sons and daughters accept it, repeat it, understand it deeply, write it completely, and make it into a book, honor it, and making into a book, honor it, those sons and daughters thereby pay homage to the Buddhas of the past, present, and future. Now, of course, there are this kind of things at the end of all sutras, mostly, longer ones especially, or sometimes big collections of sutras, where the whole sutra, because the sutra is the Buddha sharing the canopy, you know, the magical jeweled canopy of his mind, as imperfectly as you can share something with words, you know. He shares that, you know. And that's what sutras are, you see. Sukta, you know. Let us suppose, king of gods, Buddha says, that this billion-world galactic universe were as full of Tathagatas as it is covered with groves of sugarcane, with rose bushes, with bamboo thickets, with sesame gardens, and with flowers, and that a noble son or daughter were to honor them, revere them, respect and adore them, offering them all sorts of comforts and offerings for an aeon or more than an aeon. And let us, that's a lot, aeon is a million, billions of years. And let us suppose that these Tathagatas, having entered ultimate liberation, that is, parinirvana. Oh, good, I called it ultimate, rather than, I should really call it thorough. Future I will. He or she honored each of them by enshrining their preserved bodies in a memorial stupa made of precious stones, each as large as a world with four great continents, rising as high as the world of Brahma, adorned with parasols, banners, standards, and lamps. And let us suppose, finally, that having erected all these stupas for those Tathagatas, he or she were to devote an aeon or more to offering them flowers, perfumes, banners, and standards while playing drums and music. That being done, what do you think, king of gods, would that noble son or daughter receive much merit as a consequence of such activities? And Shakra, the king of the gods, replied, many merits, Lord, many merits. O Sugata, O blissful one, were one to spend hundreds of thousands of millions of aeons, it would be impossible to measure the limit of the mass of merits that that noble son or daughter would thereby gather. And the Buddha said, have faith, king of the gods, and understand this. Whoever accepts this exposition of the Dharma called instruction in the inconceivable liberation, this is, that he means the Vimalakirti, some different title. Inconceivable liberation also is a title of the Flower Ornament Sutra. Recites it and understands it deeply, he or she will gather merits even greater than those who perform the above acts. So, you know, you can build a lot of temples, offer a lot of jewels, etc., and reciting and understanding deeply this sutra, this single small sutra, will gather merits even greater than all of those acts. And one honors them, by the Dharma worship, not by material. Because, king of the gods, the enlightenment of the Buddhas arises from the Dharma, and one honors them by the Dharma worship and not by material worship. Thus it is taught, king of gods, and thus you must understand it. So in other words, that's like the Dalai Lama when he says, you know, if you want to, you know, there's a big thing that you hear in Buddhist centers about guru devotion, oh, be the guru, devote to guru, that's all you need. But actually, what is called reliance on the teacher or guru or mentor The most important component is understanding the teaching. That's what the teacher wants. The teacher doesn't want a Rolls Royce and a whatever. I mean, if they need a car, they might like a car to get around to teach more people. But the point is, they want you to understand this, what they want. That's what you're supposed to do to honor the effort of a teacher, not just give things and so forth. As we saw that earlier, we read that in the Vimalakirti. And then he goes and gives a long story about what he calls the Dharma worship. And you read that in the last chapter, in the epilogue chapter. He gives a long story about it and how they were doing the Dharma worship, that is, they were reading and honoring stupas and, I mean, sutras and so forth. And he talks about it. And you were Prince Chandra Chatra, was me, actually. No, I was Prince Chandra Chatra, who upheld the holy Dharma of the Tathagata Bhaisajiraja, king of healers. You were among all the worships, blah, 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 you know. So then he says to Maitreya, who's the next Buddha, he says, I transmit to you this teaching, and you keep it. And I attained after millions of aeons, in order that at a later time, during a later life, a similar teaching of Dharma protected by your supernatural power will spread in the world and will not disappear. Why, Maitreya, in the future there will be noble sons and daughters, gods, dragons, you know, goblins, fairies, and titans, who having planted the root of virtue will conceive the spirit of unexcelled perfect enlightenment. If they do not hear this teaching of the Dharma, they will certainly lose boundless advantages and even perish. But if they hear such a teaching, they will rejoice, will believe, and will accept it upon the crowns of their heads. Hence, in order to protect those future sons and noble sons and daughters, you must spread a teaching such as this. And then he says, write it down, hear it, think about it, blah, blah, blah. But Maitreya says, yes, I'll do that, says Maitreya. And then I think the four guardian kings, yes, the four Maharajas, the great kings of the quarters. The king of the northern quarters' name is Vaishravana. And he is the Buddha's Santa Claus. And he lives in a palace in the North Pole. And he has a giant, huge estate and palace filled with jewels. And you know, just like Santa, the Aurora Borealis comes from the radiance of the jewels in his palace. He really is Santa Claus. He really is Vaishravana. And taxi drivers in Tokyo or Kyoto will have a little Vaishravana, they call Bishamonten, in their taxi, just like, you know, other people will have, you know, some, but these are considered, and some shops will have that Bishamonten. And when I was in Japan in the 80s, when I lived there for a while, my friend Mitsu, oh, I keep forgetting his name. Anyway, my great friend, he was an hereditary priest of a Bijamonten temple, a Vaishravana temple. That's a wealth temple where the merchants went and they did prayers. They have them in China too, totally. They used to. He took me to like six different shops in Kyoto. And there's a special type of cookie that's a cookie shop, you know, but there's a special one you make just for offering to Bishamonten. You don't eat it yourself. It's really delicious, made of green bean paste and molasses, and it's a little pocket thing like this. And we got them and went and offered them to Bishamonten and all. It's really so cute, so sweet. Because wealth is good for bodhisattva. They want wealth so they can give it away, so they can do good things for people. They do. It's not like, he was so surprised, Dan Harris, this morning, I mean this afternoon. You mean it's all right to be ambitious for wealth? You don't have to give it all up to be Buddhist? Yeah, all the Buddhists want to like, ooh, just sort of live in a corner. No way, you know. Yesterday night at this charity, someone gave an introductory speech, some person supposed to know something, they were like, they were surprised. They were looking at a table of well-to-do people. Charity auction, right? Benefit, of course, money. I got for free, you know, I'm just a professor. But he looked at him and saying, wow, this is weird. Buddhists, people who are successful and Buddhists, he himself was all weirded out by it. It's interesting to see Buddhism to be successful. He's saying, and people at my table chuckled a little rudely because I couldn't restrain myself. I said, are you kidding? Buddhism has always been a success. It's a huge success on the planet, actually. Actually, what story is most famous to the largest number of people on this planet, talking about stories. Baby Jesus is very big and famous, definitely. Now, I'm not against, I love baby Jesus, but Buddha's life is much, the populations who were into knowing what it was, you know, 1,000 years ago, were far more numerous. You know, just like today, India, really, truly speaking, India is like 1.5 billion people, much more than China, because the artificial split of Pakistan and Bangladesh, you know, makes it seem like it's only 1.3 billion. But actually, there's another 3 billion in Bangladesh and Pakistan, and before the partition, the evil work of Winston Churchill to hold them back by creating conflict in the subcontinent, which he knew was the big treasure trove of Eurasia. The British knew that. That's why they liked it. So it was the crown and the jewels and all this kind of thing. And so that's like how much more than all of the Mediterranean populations. It's like 10 times more, right? And or maybe now a little different. I don't know exactly. And then China, you add China to that, you have 3 billion. Then all Southeast Asia, maybe 4 or 5 billion. So it's many more than all of these other places combined. And it was in ancient time also. So he was saying, Buddhists are a success. And they've been a big success. And they have this wonderful thing of, you want to come and trample them? Burn it all down. Then it pops up again. Not because it's some sort of dogma, membership organization, you know, corporation or something, although some people try to use it like that, but because it's scientific reality teaching to help people discover the reality of their own mind, because in the reality of if they know the reality of their own mind, they'll be happier. And in a way, it's so does Islam have that, so does Christianity, so does Zoroastrianism, so does Hinduism, so does Taoism, so does Confucianism. Anything successful of the world ideologies that helps people find something going in their own mind and find that there's something okay about being alive is appreciated by people. Especially because when you feel like you're okay inside your own skin is when you're going to be more ethical and nicer to other people. And therefore such societies will flourish. And all of the religions have this, and even humanism can have it. But the danger of humanism, atheistic humanism, is that it all becomes meaningless, you know, this sort of, it's so much afraid of the abuse of spirituality by the church in the West, of constantly dooming everyone to hell all the time, and burning them at the stake when they try to discover something. You know, like looked at the shadow of the craters on the moon, you know, old Galileo, then they told him to shut up, right? Because, you know, the moon has its own light, the church would say, you know. It's not like just reflecting the sunlight, so you couldn't have a shadow on it, you know. Right? Then they arrested him and silenced him. You know? In order to escape from that, they came up with a nice thing, which is, well, we're not going to have the kind of soul that you guys can send to hell. That's good, bravo for them. But then the danger is, they don't have any soul, they don't know what they're going to do, and all the thing that they do is meaningless, and so they become a little careless and reckless. And lately, we see them dragging the planet down into all the temperate zones become a giant Sahara. You realize, they say, you know, the James Lovelock or some people who've already lost hope, they say, buy land in British Columbia or Newfoundland or Labrador or someplace, Greenland, get some real estate in Greenland. Because those are the only places where human beings will survive if this goes on for half a century longer. They say that. They have reason to say so. You know? The Greenland, I saw the ice shield in Greenland. You know? It's this one guy from, you know, a good team from several different universities. They've been measuring the rate of melting of the ice cap on Greenland. And they went in 2009. And then I saw the show when they went back after 5 years. And the guy was sitting there like really shocked himself, making the video that I saw on PBS or something. And in the video he said, the situation now is as desperate and seemingly uncontrollable and irreversible as we predicted as a possible worst-case analysis for 50 years from 2009 has happened in 5 years. Because what we didn't realize was as it melts, the water goes down, doesn't just flow off the top, it goes down and it creates a slippage of where the ice sheet, which is a mountain of ice, you know, sits on the rock base and it starts sliding off the rock base. We didn't predict that. We didn't realize that. We sort of thought of it as melting and then it drips off into the ocean, right? But instead, it's, in addition to that, it's going underneath. And the thing, the whole the block is sliding like that. Which is, and he was like really alarmed, you know. That's a 50-year worst-case analysis in 5 years. And yet, we have these idiots who have paralyzed our Congress, who have huge tax. We pay them money to buy our cheap gas, so-called cheap gas. We pay them huge tax subsidy to find more oil that they'll never be able to burn because they have a lock on those corrupt politicians. And then they're denying that it's happening and pumping out misinformation with the billions that they're reaping from our tax dollars, from our... But it's terrible. It's really, it's not like we're going to get them in 5 years or 10 years. This should be all changed now. There's no waiting. I'm speaking 6 days from the time when we have the choice. Not that the other one will do it maybe that quickly or perfectly, but if we get the Senate and that back, at least we can throw out James Imhoff. You would be amazed if you looked in the congressional record. There's a guy called James Imhoff from Oklahoma who's an employee of the oil companies. And he goes around and he reads into the congressional record. He wastes our taxpayers' money. Page after page after page, he goes in like filibusters when nobody's there. He's not over any bill about how it's a hoax. You know, they won't allow the Navy and the Army to do things to prepare for global, for the rising sea levels and things. They can't even talk about it. Newport News in Virginia, where they have a big naval base, they're building higher docks, but they're doing it because it's easier to offload something. They can't say they're doing it because they expect the water level to rise. They are not allowed to say it. But people like that idiot, who's not working for us. I'm sorry, I know this is not Buddha Dharma, but it is. Everyone has responsibility for everything. We are responsible, not just the bad guys. If we let them continue to do this, we are responsible, right? Because why? Because this is a nice place. You can read the Vimalakirti Sutra here and the Avatamsaka Sutra. So why could we let them wreck it? And all the people who might be able to go to a nice school and read this sort of thing. And by the way, in China, they're doing a lot of solar panels and things, which is good. And they're going to dominate the world solar panel market. And these like dinosaurs in Texas are going to be like, oh, give me a quarter, give me a yuan. I'm like one on my oil industry. I have stranded assets. I'm going broke. And they are really great doing that because they love the Vimalakirti Sutra by the millions. Different kings wrote commentaries and ministers in Japan. Shotoku Taishi wrote a commentary on the one who brought Buddhism to Japan in the 8th century. He wrote a commentary on Vimalakirti Sutra. They really liked the Vimalakirti Sutra in East Asia. Absolutely. There's three translations. Wei Mo Jing, right? What time is it? Oh yeah, we're almost done. So, they, you know, when they get over certain types of attitude and spirituality can bubble up in the great land, the central country, Zhongguo, it's going to be a bunch of Vimalakirtis running around there and a bunch of goddesses. And they're really going to be, they're going to call Sinopec. They're going to go to Sinopec and say, don't accumulate more stranded assets. We can't afford that. Build some more solar panels, sell them to the New Yorkers. In Germany, Angela Merkel did great. She turned off all the nukes after Fukushima, because some of the Fukushima event in Germany would wreck all of Northern Europe, of course. You know? It says everything is very close packed there. You know? So she turned them all off. She shifted all the subsidies. I think not completely off petroleum, unfortunately, but she shifted a lot of subsidies into distributed electricity generation. And within still in office, and electricity was coming plentiful and cheap in Germany, northern climate country. And then they were complaining because the government pension funds and things were invested in utilities and their stocks were going down. So then, oh, that's terrible, we can't have that. But that's just a short-term problem. Take them out and put them in solar collecting companies and they'll go back up. Don't stop the distributed electricity. Whereas here, Arizona, New Mexico, Florida, you pay a penalty if you put solar panels on the roof of your house. Because these nasty people have pushed in ballot measures, fooling people, saying, oh, you're paying more for your electricity because these guys are going off the grid. So they should pay you a penalty for putting a solar energy on their thing. In this permanent sunshine states, that's crime. At this time, it's truly criminal. So I hope we all see to it. Sure we will. Sunshine. This is Shakyamuni. You know, the message of Vimalakirti is, this seemingly imperfect world is Shakyamuni Buddha land. It really is. Right? You remember that from Vimalakirti. It isn't just the Avatamsaka world. It isn't just the lotus world. It isn't the Avantava Sukhavati, Akshobhya. This is Shakyamuni's Buddha world. And remember at the end of the Vimalakirti, to show people, he picks up the Abhirati universe of Akshobhya, where he comes from, miniaturizes it, and he brings it and shows it to this assembly. I don't know how big it is, he doesn't really say. And they see a Buddha world that's very similar to our world, except the Buddha is always there. It's not like a land where everything is made of jewels and everybody's like semi-divine. It's a regular Buddha land, and people are there. And the difference is that the Buddha, Akshobhya, is always present as a teaching figure. Doesn't attain thorough nirvana, obviously. He sits there. And then the gods, the ladders between heaven and earth are always down, the escalators, giant escalators. And the gods come down, and the humans can go up and hang out, check out how the gods are, see what the god problems are, and enjoy perhaps a little bit of god vacation or something. And they come back down. The gods come down because they want to study with the Akshobhya, Buddha Akshobhya. That's the only difference. But he shows that in the 12th chapter. He shows where he comes from. He brings the whole universe and shows it to them, which I think is a nice image, because it's showing a sort of intermediate step between the sort of celestial Buddha verses, which we kind of glimpse of in the Avatamsaka. I was thinking today to do the Pure Land Sutra, where you would have a vision of Amitabha's Western Paradise, which is a really wonderful thing too. But we didn't get to that this round, next year. And I think it's important to make these points. And then this one seems to us so imperfect. But remember, those perfumed bodhisattvas come down, change out of being perfumed to be more ordinary. Think of this world at first as not very good. And where's the Buddha, and what kind of crappy infrastructure does he have? And then they're taught by Vimalakirti that this is actually better. You can cultivate more compassion. You are close to, you're more vulnerable yourself, you're close to other suffering beings, so you can develop your compassion as well as your wisdom. And what he doesn't say, but what they later say in the tantras, is that in this world of 100-year lifespan, with a bit of danger around, you know, and violence and stupid people, that tantra is taught here. In some of the more idyllic Buddha verses, they don't bother with tantra because people like just live for 1,000 years and they meditate and they don't need some high-speed thing. I mean, they do still, but it's not important anyway, because they have as a tradition that of the 1,000 Buddhas in this world, only 3, I think, or 4 teach tantra in that world, and Shakyamuni is one of them. And Maitreya doesn't, actually, because everybody's too relaxed in Maitreya, and they're not in a rush. They have very long lifespans, supposedly, in their cosmos, you know. And Tantra, and why is Tantra good in such a difficult circumstance? Because we die frequently. And Tantra involves mastering the processes of life and death, which eventually Buddhas have to do, so that you can lucidly die, just like you can learn to lucidly dream, fall asleep, dream and wake up, and maintain continuum of consciousness through those stages. So you can learn to lucidly die, and we'll talk about that next time in the Science of the Book of the Dead. and in the terms of that, and in terms of tantric abhidharma, what I call tantric abhidharma. That is a tantric systematized scientific way of presenting the knowledge of the subtle body and the subtle mind in tantra. Okay? So good. Any question? Any last question? Yes, oh good, you have a question. By the way, I found out you're right about Gulen. I read that article. There was a great article in New Yorker. Did you see it?
Yeah.
Really excellent report. And you were absolutely right, apparently. Although, of course, he's way going too far. You know, and under that excuse. But I apologize. So, what's your question?
Last lesson, you were talking about
how
obscure.
Talk about.
You were talking about unobscured phenomena and comparing it to emptiness of phenomena and relativity of phenomena, and I think you classified it separately, unobscured phenomena like suchness.
Yes.
Could you classified it different than the emptiness of phenomena and relativity of phenomena, like as if it is another level of consciousness or something like that. Am I understanding correctly?
I'm not understanding you correctly. Please just rephrase it.
Unobscured phenomena?
Yes.
You mentioned that. And
that's in logical terms.
Yeah.
An unobscured phenomenon means what you can directly sense with your senses. And even in the mind, there's a subtle unobscured phenomena where you have a mental image in your mind. And that is inaccessible to language and conceptuality. And in a way happens underneath it, you could say, or prior to it. Right? That's what you're referring to. Because you have three categories. You have obscured, you have unobscured, you have obscured, and you have extremely obscured. Right? Three levels, which correspond to direct sense intuition and intellectual intuition, immediated, unmediated cognition. Then you have inferential cognition, right? Where you know about the fire by seeing the smoke, right? And that's obscured. And then the extremely obscured is things like karma, biology, science, where you have to live in a community where you take reliable testimony. You know, they have that way of dividing it. Although in a way that one is subsumed under this obscured, but it's just a more difficult one. That's what you're referring to? Now connecting that to the idea of suchness, how did you do that?
I don't know. I thought you did it last time, or maybe I misunderstood.
Well, no, I did. Yes, I did, because suchness means, I differentiate between two things, suchness and thatness. And suchness and thusness are the same. Because when you say thus or such, you're saying something like this, but you're acknowledging that this, whatever it is elusive to your notion of it. Because it's such as this, but it's not just this. Whereas thatness means that it is itself an expression of the ultimate, of the absolute. So it's immanent absolute as transcendent absolute. Suchness refers to the absolute as transcendent, and thus thisness or thatness refers to the absolute as immanent with an A, right? So I make that differentiation. I haven't found that yet in a Buddhist text. Although Vasubandhu has something that seems to suggest it, I did discover. I'm sure it's there somewhere, but I didn't find it yet. So what I did was I said that when you achieve breakthrough and discover emptiness, and you have a visceral experience of the emptiness, which it has to be, you will not have that visceral experience of it unless you have understood it intellectually first, the royal reason of relativity. All things are empty of intrinsic reality because they are interrelated, completely interrelated. So when you really have that as a strong inference, and then you meditate deeply on that, which means you keep encountering things in your mind, in your experience, that seem to be things in themselves. They seem to have intrinsic reality, intrinsic objectivity, intrinsic identifiability. They seem to fit with your notion of them. And then you examine them to see if they really match with your notion, and then they dissolve under that analysis and disappear, right? So then your concept, the last thing your concept attaches to is a state of disappearance. Sort of, that's the last thing, and at the time that happens to you, you fear you're going to become annihilated, and you're going to, not know who you are, and everything's going to go, and you're going to die, or whatever. If you really deeply do it, you have that fear. But then when you break through that, you're there in some sort of spacious space like equipoise samadhi, they say, And then, but however, the momentum of your critical thing, you then look for the intrinsic reality of that thing, and then that disappears. Being disappeared disappears. So you're back here. Then, at first, maybe there's a back and forth. Then you sort of hear, and then after all, at first, you, this seems very transparent, and oh yeah, I saw it was unreal, and you kind of float around in it. Then it becomes more and more solid as you get emotionally entangled with it again, and then you again go forward, and then it disappears, and then you go back and forth, and the idea is you finally unify the two in the inconceivable wisdom, intuitive wisdom, of like unifying cognitive dissonance. Actually, the next chapter in the Vimalakirti, called The Family of the Tathagatas, talks about this reconciliating of dichotomies, which is that kind of, reflects that kind of cognitive dissonant tolerant consciousness, right? So, but when you get really, where you have them both together, then you can be aware of the direct intuitive connection to either sense or intellectual experience. At the same time, as you can see how it looked under conceptual bad negative conventional habit. So you can do those together, which again, that's inconceivable. But then that's where in Zen and Chan and some things, and it also in advanced like great perfection teachings in Tibetan and so on, and in India, ancient India before that, they talk about how enlightened consciousness reverts to ordinary consciousness. But it's not the ordinary, it's an extraordinary ordinary, is the thing. It's like, the, you know, mountains and mountains are mountains and rivers are rivers, then they're not mountains and they're not rivers, that's when they've disappeared under analysis. Even the Zen person is looking at them with great doubt. And then again, eventually at some point they're mountains and rivers again, but these are mountains and rivers reflected in the mirror surface of emptiness. So it's actually a constructive act to relate to them as mountains and rivers, because you know that they're not really mountains and rivers. So then you can actually relate to them. And then in Zen and Chan, this thing, they don't focus on the miraculous level of the inconceivable liberation that you see in the Mahayana Sutras. You know, like Vimalakirti's house that has thousands of people in it, and they're 40,000 miles tall, to listen to inconceivable liberation teaching, et cetera, et cetera. That's the Doctor Who stuff, that's sci-fi. But it may be real sci-fi, we might find out. Maybe, I'm hoping. I don't know, I can't do that, but I'm hoping. I really am hoping. And in a way, I think, like those, I did tell you that thing about my Eastern European friend, whose name I can't remember, a journalist, writer from Hungary, from Budapest, who told me that at this one, some dinner or something, during some conference, he said somewhere, you know, you Americans, you don't realize that the fact that we haven't had a nuclear war since 1945 here in Central Europe, you know, in Soviet bloc, that was before the Berlin Wall went down, you don't realize that's a miracle, because we tend to do that. You know, we have to have war. That's our thing, we have war, he said. And the Russians and us, and that we're always having war, you know. And every year, springtime, that's what you do, you have a war, you know, in Europe, that's Europe. And the fact that we haven't is a miracle, you don't realize that. But what does that mean, a miracle? That means that some agencies, some of these bodhisattvas from another universe, maybe, some kind of, you know, high, whatever it is, they have interfered with certain kind of egocentric weirdos. People who pound their table with their shoe in the UN. People who are like, you know, Mr. Putin, you know, wants to be in a men's magazine, you know, for life, forever, you know. When they lose their temper, they are destructive. And they had a lot of buttons they could have pushed and feel they can survive it, you know. And somehow they didn't quite. I once did have a little bit of a vision like it, probably my fantasy. But I saw Hayagriva. You know what Hayagriva is? Hayagriva is a fierce form of Avalokiteshvara. His sort of usual form is, so there are different forms, six arms, four arms, two arms, usually sort of a reddish color, like a maroon color, big bulging face with three eyes, like a demonic looking, flaming hair, like just flames for hair, and they say eyebrows are supernova flames, you know, like universe destroying flames. It's a very ferocious thing. And I saw a thing where certain people, I won't even say what, were maybe contemplating a particular nuclear use and even fooled around with it, even press some buttons. And then I was amazed that Hayagriva put his hair into the electric circuit. That flaming hair went, and they were like, well, Mr. Whatever, I won't even say which country, but if we were pressing everything, there's nothing wrong with any circuit, but the impulse is not going. We don't know what it is. And then that particular person looked up and they saw like, they saw an archangel up there or something. And they, okay, cool. We'll do something else. I actually saw something like that, which is totally probably my fantasy. Hair was just like yours. Like burning, blazing, with like supernova flames, you know. Fusion flames, or like center of the sun, you know, really strong. So that's a level of inconceivable, liberation. And it might be just a fantasy, and you know, we just have to tolerate whatever happens. But you know, there's you know, I've been through three or four people winning elections since I saw what was possible in life in my 20s, and I'm not ready for the fifth one. The fifth lunatic we cannot have. Instead, we have to take the poor glutton for punishment who's been the ultimate battered woman who's been battered for 30 years. You know, you didn't do anything in 30 years. No, because you were battering her. You and your friends were just battering this woman. You know, there was a great, did you see last Sunday's Times? Susan Faludi wrote an awesome article about, since 1992, what has been happening to that woman, and all this thing about everybody hates. Why does everybody hate a perfectly nice person? She didn't murder people. Vince Foster was murdered. It's ridiculous. But it's sort of out there by this concerted, purposeful effort by people for 34 years, is it? No, 24 years, 19, 24 years. And they started in Arkansas, actually, because she wouldn't bake cookies. She had to be a lawyer while the husband was governing and also misgoverning himself. Anyway, never mind. Thank you very much. Good night.